you got to have a little bit more love, because I don't know what the mastering engineer is going to do, if they're going to run it through more gear, if they're not, so on and so forth. So I want to make sure that there's some analog love in there. And and I mean, my master bus is just stupid. I mean, it's like there's probably 15 plugins on it.
No.
Yeah.
And you're still sending out to mastering after that? Or is this for actual mastering?
No, no. That's my thing that I send to mastering. But at the end of the day, I'm really trying to make it so the mastering engineer doesn't have a lot to do.
Right.
Not that they don't have a lot to work with, and there's a difference. Like for me, I'm not printing mixes. You know, my hottest mixes that I've ever printed are hitting like -12 RMS. But normally I'm trying to hit somewhere around 15 to 14. And my rationalization between that is, okay, well, if the artist doesn't go to mastering, this will hold up on streaming services, because that's pretty much what they're all targeting, is that, you know, -14, -13.
Exactly.
So I know the mix is going to hold up. However, you know, we always go to mastering, but at the same time, I don't want to do any of that stuff. I mean, I want to do light compression to hold things together. I mean, my master bus compression is not meant to glue the whole track together. If my track is not gelled together, it means that I did not do a proper balance and pan job in the early stages. And that's
interesting. Yeah.
And that's a fault for me. So from the start, I always have my compressors on. I don't have any EQ or any stereo effect or tape saturation effects or anything like that on, but my compressors are always on, because for me it's gain staging. If I can look over to my right and see my SSL flick to where I know it should be flicking, then I know my Manly is going to be flicking where I know it should be flicking. And I know that the gain staging throughout will work. And if it's not, if it's going too far, I know that I need to pull back a little bit. And if it's not going far enough, I know that I can probably push in a little bit more if the genre calls for that.
So
it really is that scientific approach of like trying to figure out all the signal flow stuff, which is very important, obviously, in the digital realm, which is not as important analog, because you can fluctuate things and things sound better when we push. But, you know, it's really trying to find the sweet spots of all these things and sweet spots of plugins, and making sure that, you know, a lot of engineers that I know will have these plugins on and doing this stuff, and they don't realize that all of these plugins are modeled to be hitting it like a normal VU meter and normal, you know, levels that we would before any plugins existed, you know, which is around -20 to -18, you know, RMS, you know, depending on the type of source it is. And so, yeah, that's why your 1176 plugin looks really weird in the way it's being set, and why it's reacting in different ways. And, you know, not saying that you're not doing it for a creative purpose, because that's a completely different story. But if you're trying to tame something and you're like, why is my 1176 cranked all the way, the input cranked all the way up, or the input is all the way off and I'm still getting 8 dB of compression, then that's where the things, you know, you have to figure that stuff out, especially in the digital realm.
So cool. Wow. So tell me, what do you do about mastering? You have like a specific guy that you work with, or girl, or do you have several? Or is it the artist deciding?
I usually have the talk with the artist. I have three tiers of mastering people in the sense of price. We have the people who are, you know, $50 to $100, $100 to $200, and then the $200, $250 and up people. And so for each stage, I want to provide the artist options, because the last thing I ever want to hear from an artist is, all right, you master it. You know, mixing engineers are not mastering engineers. And, you know, it's the same reason why certain tracking engineers are not producers and certain bass players are not keyboard players. You know what I mean? Like, everyone has a role. And I believe the mastering engineer is a big role. And it also is another stage that someone else can listen to your music that hasn't heard it and has no idea and wants to be creative. So for me, the most important thing that I always look for in mastering is someone who's going to take chances. I would rather get a master back that I said, man, you went way too far, but it's awesome. Like, let's rein it in, than someone who just does kind of that transparent bringing levels up and like, well, I could have just thrown on some more compression and some EQ and brought the level up to where it needs to be to compete. So I think for me, just like I would say, you should hire a producer because of what they've produced and what their tastes of music are. You should hire mixing engineers, tracking engineers, like everyone on the process should be hired because of the vision and the end goal of art.
Amazing.
And so for, yes, I have you the cheaper end of the spectrum. I have a couple guys who are local, who do a great job for the budget. Then in the moderate level, I would say I use a guy at Airshow Mastering. His name's David Glazer, and sometimes we use Anna.
I've heard his name on the show before, actually.
David's great.
Yeah.
And, you know, great price point, great work. He digs into things, you know, we have friendly conversations about things, and that's what I want. And that's what I want the artists to want, because I want them to have the experience. And he's okay taking, you know, notes if I'm like, hey, I think we're there, but can you push this? And he'll be like, all right, let's see what happens. And we'll get and have a nice discussion. Then the other people that are in that range is a guy who I'm actually using for the first time right now, which we're enamored with, is Ian over at Capitol. He has done if you're familiar with the Magic Death Eye compressor and that stuff, that's him. If you're not, check it out, because it's crazy. He has a plug-in version, and then he builds this modified Fairchild circuitry, which is just insane. And
okay.
So that I would say is mid-grade. And then for the people who have the money, and we, you know, and the projects that have the money and that we can really afford to test, I love to send out to Brian Lucy. I love to send out to Adam Aon. I love people over at Sterling, and mm-hmm. you know, that kind of thing. So, I use quite a few. I don't like to stick to one, and you know, maybe that's a flaw. Maybe I should figure that out for myself. But I also think it's the same reason, like, if I'm going to do a more aggressive indie rock or alternative rock, I don't want to hire someone that's not used to doing that kind of material or hasn't worked on material that I love. Like,
right. It's like you were saying before with like who has the right vision for this track. You
know? Exactly. I mean,
different mastering engineers are good for different things. I totally get that.
Exactly. And you know, their gear is set up for that. You know, everyone accumulates their gear and their tools of their trade and their skill set for what they are doing. Yeah. Could I send a pop track or, you know, bubblegum pop track to Brian Lucy and have him do a great job? Of course. I mean, he's a world-renowned mastering engineer. But at the same time, if I know that I've got a song that sounds more like Foo Fighters, Arctic Monkeys, Black Keys, yeah, he's going to nail it because he's the one that does those albums. You know,
right.
I want those people to work on it because they already have the idea of like, oh, I know why you picked me. I know where we need to go.
Love it. Wow. Dude, we've talked about so many things. If you want to get a little bit more serious before we close up the conversation,
sure.
Are you comfortable talking about your nonprofit,
sure.
Arts for Mental Health?
Yes,
right?
I'm more than happy to talk about it. So last year, unfortunately, I had a family member who decided to take their own life, which was a really surreal day, to say the least. It was a day where I had literally probably mixed the best song I had ever mixed, and had beaten a very well-known mixer who charges a lot of money. And I was on cloud nine. I mean, like, I was euphoric, and we went out to dinner and we were having drinks and stuff with friends. And then all of a sudden I got that phone call and it was like down to the floor. You know, it was like you're on this roller coaster and I thought it was only going to be up and up and up and then right down. And, you know, it took a while to kind of really sort through that process and sort through the idea of what had happened and why it had happened and what this person was going through who didn't really speak out to family about it. And I realized that I wanted to try and do whatever I could to try and help people who might be in a similar situation. And so I started this whole thing that right now is sending money to nonprofits. Unfortunately, because of the whole COVID thing, we actually didn't apply and go through the whole thing to become a nonprofit ourselves, which, given the circumstances of the world, that was honestly for the better. But we have gotten a bunch of donations. We've raised, you know, over like $3,000 or $4,000 that we're sending off this month to two really well-known organizations and groups that deal with helping people with mental health and depression issues, focusing on trying to get people to find a different way than obviously ending their own life, which is obviously very personal to me. And and honestly, the amount of support that we've received and the amount of people reaching out and wanting to help is just like mind-boggling. You know, I assumed it would be something small that, you know, we'd raise, you know, maybe $1,000, $2,000 and we'd be able to give it to these groups and they'd be able to help people, to it turning into a much bigger thing where people were really like, hey, we want to help. We want to get behind this. We want to do what we can to see this through. And I just think that that's awesome. And, you know, it's such a prevalent thing. I mean, just, you know, before we started this interview, I talked to you about a friend who had just gone through this. I literally was called yesterday and told that I had a friend who took their life yesterday. It's heavy. I mean, it really is.
Yeah.
And this was a person that I had known for quite a few years and, you know, we were very close. And, you know, it's so important that people try to get help and know that they can get help and know that there's no stigma behind this and that there shouldn't be. I mean, I think the biggest problem is there's so much stigma behind this whole problem that people are afraid to speak out. They're, you know, it's kind of like, you know, being a crack addict in the 90s, you know, it's that kind, same kind of stigma of like, you know, you're this one person, so you will do all these bad things and that's what you're categorized as. And there's more to it. And I really think that it's something that this country that I live in really doesn't get right and really doesn't put enough emphasis on. And, you know, and I'll be honest, a lot of people don't want to talk about it. I will say that the hardest part about doing what I'm doing and trying to fight for raising money and advocacy of this sort is the subject matter. Like, even just the subject matter, people do not want to really, like, they'll support and they'll talk to me about it, but they don't want to put it out into the world kind of thing. You know, mm-hmm. I make the lighthearted joke that it would be easier for me to save whales than to save humans. And wow. there's something true about that. You know, when you think about even just Facebook posts and all that stuff of like, when people are sending out stuff, it's, you know, I get so many animal cruelty things every single day to maybe
really
one depression, suicide link thing every other day. And it's just really hard to talk about it because of the fact that there's so much of this stigma tied to this issue and people don't want to talk about it, or some people do, but they don't want to be too public about it. And I feel like if I can be public about it and I can help other people, even if I can't help a lot of people. At least I'm helping some people out. And if my story can help other people